Flying. Flying. Dreams of flight. Reach out your arms. Step into the air and rise into the blue. Tilt your outstretched limbs. Lean into the arc of a dive. And carve slow curves for the infinite vault of heaven. Glide past cloud-capped towers. Fly through weightless valleys. Command every swoop and lift with no more than a shaping thought or feathering gesture.
Flying. I'm flying. I've been dreaming of flying all my life. Though in my flying dreams, I am embraced by a protective skin of metal. I am borne up on wings that are rounded into a perfect ellipse. And I am flung through the heedless air by a four-bladed propeller powered by a V12 liquid-cooled Rolls-Royce Merlin engine. I dream of flying in a Spitfire. But maybe that's scarcely surprising that I dream of flying in a Spitfire. I am, after all, a baby boomer, born in 1953, just 8 years after the end of the Second World War.
I'm John Wallace, and I've always been interested in the Second World War. It's dancing, it's music, it's social history, and in particular, it's military history, especially the history of the RAF, its pilots, and of course, the aeroplanes that they flew.
In fact, in the year I was born, Spitfires were still flying in combat for National Air Forces in the Middle East. As a child, I made Airfix Spitfire models. I read and reread comics in which fearless, determined and irrepressibly cheerful Spitfire pilots effortlessly fired off exclamations at their chums while nonchalantly firing their machine guns at enemy Messerschmitt ME-109s and Focke Wulf FW-190s. And in an era that rightly glorified the heroes of a war that had ended only 20 years before, I consumed documentaries about the Battle of Britain with wide-eyed, childlike enthusiasm. Scrambles, takeoffs, aerial battles, and young men in flying suits standing, slightly uneasily, in rows became so familiar it was as if I, the impressionable schoolboy, had been there with them, flying alongside them, sharing in their epic deeds. But so many years later, as an adult, something happened that added an altogether different layer of meaning to these sedimentary strata of childhood remembrances. This fascination and guileless admiration for Spitfires, their pilots and their warrior deeds. I was living in London, working in the West End, and one day had a drink in a Soho pub. I noticed a framed poem on the wall, wandered over to read it, and stood amazed, dazzled, overcome by its brief and fleeting beauty. Just 14 lines long, more of a sonnet than a poem, it was called High Flight, and it was written in 1941 by a 19-year-old RAF pilot called John Gillespie McGee. Those 14 brief lines contained an entire rapturous elegy to the sheer unfettered joy of flying a Spitfire. In this one brief sonnet was all the exhilaration of hurling a thoroughbred aircraft through the skies, a machine that was so fast, so responsive, so intuitively attuned to the pilot's commands that the plane became an extension of his own movements, his will, and his courage. And in that moment of reading, I longed to fly in a Spitfire, to feel it, to breathe its scent, to know how it felt in flight, to let it take me high into the endless blue. But it was just a dream of flying. After all, how was I ever going to fly a single-seat fighter aeroplane over half a century old? Just a dream, but a precious one. So who was this visionary poet, John Gillespie McGee, who commanded language and a deadly aerial weapon with such easy grace? John McGee was the son of missionary parents. His mother was English, his father American. John was born in Shanghai in 1922 and was educated both at an American school in China and at rugby school in Warwickshire. In 1939, he travelled to the USA and finished his schooling there. And at the outbreak of war that same year, he was determined to fly for the RAF, but was not allowed to return to Britain. So, like hundreds of other young men in the USA, he illegally crossed the border into Canada to enlist with the Royal Canadian Air Force. Having trained in Canada and eventually in Britain, John McGee received his wings as a pilot officer by 1941. He was assigned to the newly formed No. 412 Royal Canadian Air Force Fighter Squadron based at Digby in Lincolnshire, and he saw active service over France. On the 3rd of September 1941, he undertook the test flight of a new Mark V Spitfire, a version designed for high-altitude operations with the specific intention of shooting down German reconnaissance aircraft. During the course of the flight, up to a height of 30,000 feet, John McGee composed the poem he later entitled High Flight. In July 2015, I decided to go and see for myself the Lincolnshire landscape that must have become so familiar to John McGee. So I cycled there from my home in Cheshire.
This is where John McGee's story begins and ends, really, because this is where he was transferred to when he came over to England with the Royal Canadian Air Force. He was a member of Royal Canadian Air Force's 412 squadron, which flew from here. And on the 3rd of September 1941, he was asked to test a new Spitfire Mark V, which he flew up to about 30,000 feet. And he said afterwards that during the flight, during that ascent to 30,000 feet, the idea for the poem came to him, and when he got back, he wrote it down and he sent it in a letter to his parents.
That letter John McGee wrote to his parents finished with the words, "I'm enclosing a verse I wrote the other day. It started at 30,000 feet and was finished soon after I landed." Near to RAF Digby was a pilot's training school, now Royal Air Force College Cranwell.
And near here is an airfield where, on the 11th of December 1941, a young pilot called Ernest Aubrey took off in an Oxford training aircraft, and he flew eastwards towards RAF Digby. At the same time, John Gillespie McGee took off in a Spitfire from RAF Digby, and in low cloud, somewhere between here and there, they had a mid-air collision, and both aircraft fell to the ground. There was a witness on the ground, a farmer, who said that he saw John McGee trying to get out of his aircraft as the aircraft plummeted to earth. And in fact, he did get out, but too close to the ground. He never had a chance to open up his parachute. And so that's how he was killed.
The crash took place in the skies above the small hamlet of Roxholm, and John McGee was buried in the neighbouring village of Scopwick, where I sought his final resting place.
He was buried here, which is a proper war graves cemetery, and he was buried here in December of 1941. Age 23, pain. Oh my, oh Lord, I found it. He's here. Oh, it's quite a shock. John Gillespie McGee, pilot, Royal Canadian Air Force, 11th of December 1941, age 19. And look, they've carved the first couple of lines of the poem on the grave. Part of the official letter to his parents read, "Your son's funeral took place at Scopwick Cemetery near Digby Aerodrome at 2:30 p.m. on Saturday, the 13th of December 1941. The service being conducted by Flight Lieutenant S.K. Belton, the Canadian Padre of this station. He was accorded full service honours, the coffin being carried by pilots of his own squadron." So, here you are. Here is his last resting place. And here are his skies as well.
At the heart of this story is the plane itself, the Supermarine Spitfire. Effortlessly elegant, exquisitely streamlined and uniquely beautiful in flight, its crucial role in the Second World War imbued it with a luster and heroic quality that seems to be ever more magnified with the passing of time. The Spitfire has become part of our national consciousness, a symbol of all that is best in being English, a representation of what we hold most dear, timeless and noble in our national character. The Spitfire seems to touch the heart of everyone, and when seen in blue English skies, flying over a green English landscape, the sight and sound of it can conjure up an upwelling of immeasurable feeling that seems to express our most profound sense of Englishness. The story of the Spitfire is well known. It was designed by R.J. Mitchell of the Supermarine Company of Southampton in response to the Air Ministry's 1931 orders for a new and modern fighter capable of exceptional manoeuvrability and speed. Supermarine had designed award-winning superfast seaplanes for the Schneider Trophy races in the 1920s and 30s. These formed the basis for the Spitfire, and its first true incarnation flew in 1936. The Supermarine factory employed a wide range of aero technicians during those Spitfire development years in the 1930s. One of those was George Nicholas, who joined Supermarine as a 17-year-old in 1931. His work involved airframe stress, balance and centre of gravity. George is now 100 years old and living in Woking, Surrey. I went to meet him for a bit of a chat about his days with Spitfire.
This is an interesting book, this, isn't it?
There's my wife.
Oh, wonderful, yes.
John, Susan and Eric.
Yep. Where was that? Was that taken in the stress office?
Yes.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Okay.
That was taken in camp.
Right.
And I was having a quiet snooze.
It's allowable, it's allowable. And there you are, in the stress office.
Yes. That was the colleague.
Yeah.
Couple of
Doug Scarlett and Murray Sam. White. Okay. And then we have
R.J. Mitchell.
Yes. That's the core team who developed the Spitfire. Yeah. Mutt Summers.
Yes. Sat in the mat.
And here we have.
Yeah, that's when I was married.
Your wedding day, 16th of December 1939.
That's right.
Shortly after the outbreak of World War II. My. Oh my. You have seen a lot of people in your life, haven't you?
Yes.
A lot of generations ahead of you. So tell me, you are now, what, 100 years old?
Yes, I was born in October 1940. Well, I went to Taunton School, Southampton.
Yeah.
Then I left there. I joined the Supermarine Aviation Company.
And how old were you when you joined Supermarine?
16.
Well, you must have known Mitchell then, didn't you? You knew R.J. Mitchell would have been your boss, Reginald Mitchell.
Yes. He was. He never saw all the profits or the work that he did.
Right.
For the country.
What was your job when you joined?
Office boy.
Office boy? You joined as an office boy, right.
And I was in the stress office.
Ah, yes. What did the stress office do? What was their function?
Well, there was a very strict system of checking weights.
Mm-hmm.
And at one time I was responsible for checking weights and to make sure that the aeroplane CG
mm-hmm.
was in a certain place.
Right. CG being centre of gravity, I assume.
Because weight and centre of gravity here are aeroplanes,
yes.
Very important.
Of course. So you were working on all the components to make sure that they were the right weight or as little weight as possible and that the plane was balanced.
Well, I played my part in
yes,
it, so,
yeah.
So I did everything, but
right.
I did what I could.
Okay. What role did you undertake with regard to the Spitfire?
I mean, in the construction of the wing, you have a spar
mm-hmm.
and then roots.
Uh-huh.
The first design was a metal nose and ribs coming off. Well, they had what was a linen covering.
Mm-hmm.
As I got on in the office, I replaced that fabric covering
mm-hmm.
by thin aluminium sheeting.
Right.
And that gave the wing. I much improved the torsional qualities of the wing.
Mm-hmm.
As the engine got more powerful, more torque, so we had to increase the size of the fin
mm-hmm.
to overcome the torque. She had quite a large fin towards the end.
Yes, yeah, because of the greater power of the engines.
Yes.
Right, right. Well, I wonder if you've ever seen this book before. Spitfire's Forgotten Designer.
Now, that's Terry Smith.
Yeah, and he took over from
when R.J. Mitchell died.
What sort of a man was he, do you remember?
Like the rest of us, got up on the job.
Yeah, yeah.
Made the best that he could.
It's your story, really.
I was a part of it.
Yeah, but you get mentioned in there too.
Oh, really?
Yes, on several occasions. I can't quite remember which pages you get mentioned, but you are in there several times.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you, sir. No. Thank you very much indeed.
Hope I'm made a useful contribution.
Oh, you have. You absolutely have. I can't tell you how much. It's been a thrill to meet you. It really has. And I do thank you for your time. It's much appreciated.
Meeting George Nicholas was a first-hand encounter with the Spitfire of fact, rather than the Spitfire of poetry, imagination and longing. And I wanted to know more about how it felt, what it was like to fly one. Of course, there are Spitfires you can go and look at in aviation museums and at air shows, but I was looking for a tangible glimpse of what John McGee experienced when he flew a Spitfire. Squadron leader Wilfred Duncan Smith was a Spitfire pilot who said, "You don't just strap yourself in, you buckle the Spitfire on, like girding on armour." Well, there's one place in West Sussex where you can get a pretty good idea of what flying a Spitfire is like, courtesy of Brian Smith, a former pilot with the RAF and with British Airways. Because he's built a Spitfire simulator in an outbuilding next to his home, and I had an appointment to fly it.
Last night we drove down to Petworth to stay with my dear friend, Mr. Dave Patterson, and his lovely partner Kat, and we are now proceeding this morning to visit Mr. Brian Smith, who has a Spitfire simulator in a shed in his back garden.
It will.
It'll take quite. It's taken me. Well, I forget. It was 10 years ago when I did my flight.
We were really
still smiling.
And how did this whole project start? Because this is, well, it must be unique in the world, I would have thought.
Well, I learned to fly at White Waltham Airfield. Mm. I learned to fly there in 1962, so in 2012, the two fellows that followed along behind me and also retired, and they phoned me up and said, "Oi, what are we going to do to celebrate 50 years, you see, of flying?" So we went into Maidenhead, where there is an air transport auxiliary museum. And when we checked in, the lady there said, "Would you like to fly the Spitfire simulators?"
Yes.
We went upstairs, and in a big room there was something like this, mm-hmm. not quite the same, mm-hmm. and that gave me the idea.
Yeah.
And then we were driving home, and Mrs. Smith said, "You're a bit quiet."
"You're very quiet," I said. "I was quite worried. That was such a good experience."
Yeah. He said, "I'm going to make one." Said, "Oh my God." And then there we are.
And how long did it take you to make it?
We all aged about 10 years, but it took us about 9 months.
I didn't see him in the house for quite a few days. Yeah.
Well, this is the ultimate boy's toy, isn't it? Yeah. It's completely, absolutely, every boy wants one of these, please. Yeah. Right.
Okay, now climb up the steps, put both feet on the seat.
Yes.
That's what Spitfire pilots did.
Okay,
and
yes.
Sit down, make yourself comfortable.
Right, okay, that goes in there. Right.
And there's a crowbar if you get into trouble.
So pull it down, pull it in.
And all the way up. That's it. And it locks into a little latch in there.
Yep.
That's it.
Yep.
So, if we start off with a little bit of taxi.
All right.
And it's going to push that throttle all the way forward. Nice, smooth, continuous power. And when that power kicks in, not now, keep the power coming.
There's the right.
More power, and we'll get ready with the right foot forward now, hold it like that, just hold it with the air,
yeah.
Hold the right foot, the gear's gone, the gear let's come up because we've been playing with that. Let's do that again.
Oh!
Okay, reset it.
Did I do that?
No,
what did I do?
No, that's all right. Because we were playing with a lever.
God, I just thought, God, this is going to be an expensive day.
I've got plenty of
How much do you need for a new one?
Right.
Right, okay. Ah, oh, with a puff of smoke as well. Right, so...
We're going to take it off on the other end. It's fine, you're as before. So, nice and gently with that power. Keep it coming on. As soon as you hear that sound coming on now, right, wait for it to swing. Now, right foot forward now. More. Hold it like that. Perfect. Perfect, perfect, perfect. More power. More power, more right foot. That's it. Feet in the middle now. You can let go with the left hand, keep it there, let go, and stick back gently. Stick back.
Ah!
No, no.
Ah! I'm up. By golly.
You did it.
I'll get in the neck from the wing commander if he sees that take off.
Just done.
Okay.
Flying over the airfield. You're going to be worn out.
It's amazing. It's absolute. It's all my inner balances are responding. You know, I feel completely.
This is a view from the control tower.
Right.
Oh, this is what you've
just done. That's me. Oh, Brian, this is just. This is just extraordinary. Oh, a bit wobbly there. Oh, I've lots of clearance though. Yeah.
Right through.
Yeah.
It looks tight.
Yeah.
How does Nevada feel, John?
Unbelievable. Oh, there I go. Oh, yeah. Whoa. Absolutely. Oh, that's amazing. And there I am pulling up. Yeah. And then I'm going to do it. Never flown an aeroplane before, but it felt like flying an aeroplane, and all my senses, my interior sense of gravity, was being affected by turning and climbing and dropping. So it felt like the real deal to me. I can't explain it, but it felt as near as I would imagine it.
We had four golfers flying the other day.
Yeah.
And the first man to fly, they were all friends, so you can imagine the banter. And the first man to fly. He was flying it like this, you see.
Yes.
And I said to him, "You don't drive your car like that, do you?"
Yeah.
And his friend said, "Yeah, he does."
This is just a little glimpse into what a pilot might have experienced. And because this whole thing is inspired by John Gillespie McGee's poem, that's what I really was after, knowing just in small part what it is like to be in a Spitfire. And this, obviously, the experience you have, the sensation, is to me completely real. Good. I was there. Yeah. I was absolutely there. Right, Dave, I think it's your turn.
Yeah.
It's your turn.
Right.
Yeah. And I will grab a cup of coffee,
yes,
if I may.
Yes, this is yours in here, actually. That's...
I'd seen where John McGee flew, and I had found his final resting place. I talked to a former Spitfire engineer, and I had flown in a Spitfire simulator. Now it was time to learn something of the environment of a Second World War fighter station, so I visited the Tangmere Military Aviation Museum near Chichester. It's close to the former Tangmere RAF fighter station that was heavily bombed in 1940 and was under the command of Group Captain Douglas Bader, the celebrated fighter pilot who had lost both his legs in a pre-war flying accident. RAF Tangmere became the home of 616 Squadron, whose pilots included Johnny Johnson, the highest-scoring Allied pilot against the Luftwaffe. He was credited with 34 individual victories over enemy aircraft, as well as 7 shared victories, 3 shared probables, 10 damaged, 3 shared damaged, and 1 destroyed on the ground.
Spitfire Fighter Fund. Do it now. Now, just as a matter of interest, in raising money for buying Spitfires, they put it out to the public, and people could contribute to building a Spitfire, and they could contribute to building a particular Spitfire that would then take on the name of the particular contributors. So there was, for example, a Spitfire called the Dorothy Spitfire, which was so called because women called Dorothy all contributed to its construction. John McGee, pilot and poet. John Gillespie McGee was born in Shanghai on the 9th of June, 1922, the son of Reverend John McGee, US citizen, and Faith Backhouse McGee of British parentage and birth. Till about 11:40 a.m., all went well, but on letting down through the low cloud into the Wellingor circuit, they intersected the flight path of an airspeed Oxford. McGee struggled with a jammed cockpit canopy and bailed out. Was too low for his parachute to open, and he struck the ground in a field north of Wroxholm Hall in the parish of Ruskington. John had recently sent home to his parents a copy of his latest poem, High Flight, and his father included the verses in his church magazine, published on December the 21st, 1941. The poem was seen by a Washington journalist who placed it in his newspaper, and so provided the springboard from which it leapt to flame. High Flight epitomizes the airman's joy in flight, and its recital by President Ronald Reagan as a valediction after the Challenger shuttle tragedy ensured its place in the hearts of all who love to fly.
Slipped the surly bonds of earth to touch the face of God.
Oh. Oh my. It's big, isn't it? It's big. Yeah. For some reason I didn't think it would be so big.
Say 9 feet in front of the cockpit was the
Just bigger. I don't know how big I expected them to be, but they just look a whole lot bigger than I thought.
Like RAF Tangmere, RAF Biggin Hill was another crucially important RAF fighter station during the Battle of Britain. The fighter squadrons here claimed 1,400 enemy aircraft at a cost of 453 aircrew. And like Tangmere, Biggin Hill was bombed by the Luftwaffe no less than 12 times between August 1940 and January 1941. Close to many former RAF buildings, St George's Royal Air Force Chapel of Remembrance is dedicated to the memory of all those who served at Biggin Hill.
We've noticed the fact that right outside the chapel, there's a Spitfire here, and over there is a Hurricane.
Today, the former RAF aerodrome is now London Biggin Hill Airport, which handles all manner of aircraft, including private jets, helicopters, and one particular aeroplane that I had a very special date with. This is MJ627, formerly a single-seater Spitfire Mark IX, built in 1943 and fitted with a Rolls-Royce Merlin 66 engine. She entered service with No. 441 Silver Fox Squadron of the Royal Canadian Air Force in 1944 and flew sorties from Belgium and the Netherlands. This is Pilot Officer Sid Bregman, and on September the 27th, he took off in MJ627 to patrol the Arnhem area. At around 6,000 feet, some 15 enemy fighters were engaged, and Bregman was later credited with the downing of a Messerschmitt Bf 109. Remaining with 441 Squadron, MJ627 was kept busy during the latter part of 1944, protecting Lancaster bombers on bombing missions over Germany. Having survived the war, in 1950 she was converted by Vickers Armstrong into a T-9 trainer aircraft with two seats, providing 10 years of service with the Irish Air Corps. She was acquired by her present owner in 1976, was comprehensively restored, and from the beginning of 2015, new Civil Aviation Authority rules allowed MJ627 to provide passenger flights for paying members of the public. And on Wednesday, the 29th of July, 2015, it was my turn to fly.
My aeroplane. For now. My aeroplane. Oh boy. Oh boy. Here it is. A two-seater. But you probably guessed this a long time ago, that the ultimate part of this particular film was going to be me flying in a plane, in a Spitfire. Well, this is the moment now. In about 10 minutes, I'm going to be climbing into this thing. So, I mustn't forget this. Right. Pen?
Okay. Okay. You want to jump in?
Yes, certainly.
Make yourself at home.
Will do.
Feeling. I don't know. I'm just so excited. I can't believe it. After 30 years of waiting, and this is it. So yes, I am, for once, fairly speechless. But probably not when I get back. But yeah. How are you feeling?
Good. Just duck your head a bit.
Right.
Oops.
It is John, yes, indeed. Yes, thank you. Yes. And it is Richard, isn't it?
Yes.
Okay.
It's been a long day.
Yeah, oh God, Richard, I'm so sorry. You don't ever get... Do you ever get bored?
Not yet. I'm dreading your day. One day, I will wake up and
I'll put you on. Oh, well, I'm glad it's not today anyway. Oh, good. This is what John McGee and thousands of other Spitfire pilots saw. The cockpit, the instrument panel, the wings, and 9 feet of Spitfire in front of the pilot. In fact, while you were on the ground, you couldn't see ahead because of the upward sloping angle of the plane, so pilots would weave from side to side as they taxied for takeoff. Then they could see where they were going. The propellers turning clockwise so fast and with so much force that the torque is making the plane pull right. So the pilot's foot is hard down on the left rudder to keep the plane straight as it accelerates the takeoff. Right hand on steering column, left hand on the throttle. Push forward throttle to reach takeoff speed. Tail lifts at 60 miles an hour. Nose lifts at 100 miles an hour. And we're airborne. Transfer left hand to control column, right hand to undercarriage lifting gear. Pull lever out, up and in again. Undercarriage up. Climbing at 180 miles an hour. Leveling out at around 5,000 feet. Now it's my turn to fly. You can tell because my head stopped moving and I'm looking straight ahead to keep the horizon steady. The pilot tells me to look in the mirror above his cockpit. I can see him waving both hands at me, so I know I'm flying. She's so sensitive, all it takes is the thumb and forefinger of my right hand to control her. I'm lightly holding the large O-ring at the top of the control column, with my hand just right of the machine gun firing button. To the right, then back to the horizontal again. The pilot takes the controls again and puts her into a sharp battle turn. It feels an awful lot faster than it looked, and I've just left my stomach in the sky somewhere over the green fields of Kent. The plane levels out, hits the horizontal, and the wings stop dead in mid-air. The pilot tells me that we pull just 1.5 Gs on that turn. In combat, pilots would have been pulling 9 Gs. Now we're heading north, to the estuary of the River Medway, for some fun and games. First of all, a wing slip, with wings in the vertical position. Back to the horizontal. Now for a barrel roll. Speed between 180 and 300 miles an hour. Bring up the nose to about 30 degrees above the horizon and slam the control column hard to the left, then let her roll, keeping the revs up. Level out and repeat the procedure. Heading back to Biggin Hill, I take the controls again. And the pilot floats her down for a landing, so gentle I don't even feel it. It is done. I have flown in a Spitfire. Better than that, I have flown a Spitfire. I have sat where John McGee and thousands of his fellow pilots sat. Felt the plane tremble like a greyhound. Felt its breath of hot metal and oil. Heard it roar like a hellhound. And flown a craft that could switch from an aerial dancing partner into a wild animal in a split second.
Shot at by aeroplanes, and we weren't being fought, and we weren't in terrible conditions, and I don't know how they did it. I just don't know how they did it. But at least now I have a little inkling about the sound and the smell and the feel, and right, cut.
But there is just one more thing, though.
Oh, I have slipped the surly bonds of earth and danced the skies on laughter's silvered wings. Sunward I've climbed and joined the tumbling mirth of sun-split clouds and done 100 things you have not dreamed of. Wheeled and soared and swung high in the sunlit silence. Hovering there, I chased the shouting wind along and flung my eager craft through footless halls of air. Up up the long, delirious, burning blue, I've topped the windswept heights with easy grace, where never lark or even eagle flew. And while with silent lifting mind I've trod the high, untrespassed sanctity of space, put out my hand and touch the face of God.
This is the poem High Flight by John Gillespie McGee. Oh, I have slipped the surly bonds of earth and danced the skies on laughter-silvered wings. Sunward I've climbed and enjoyed the tumbling mirth of sun-split clouds and done 100 things you have not dreamed of. Wheeled and soared and swung high in the sunlit silence, hovering there. And I've chased the shouting wind along and flung my eager craft through footless halls of air. Up, up the long, delirious, burning blue, I've topped the windswept heights with easy grace, where never lark or even eagle flew. And while with silent lifting mind I've trod the high, untrespassed sanctity of space, put out my hand and touch the face of God. It's difficult to say that.
That was great. That was just perfect. I know, me too. I was, yeah.
It's a good practice run. Do you want to do it again?
No.
No, no, no.